on. Seem like the whole city go against me. Every time I'm in the street, I hear yak, yak,
yak, yak. Man down, where you from? All right.
Welcome back, Swag Guys Bubble. This is your commissioner, Isaac Schumacher, and this is week 7 of your fantasy basketball weekly recap. James is on the road this week, so you're only going to get a basketball video from me, and I'm going to try my absolute best to edit this thing and get it out as quickly and as good as I can. I'm doing this off of my laptop because I don't have James's phone, so that's why the audio and the visual is a little bit funky, but bear with me. We're going to try to get this done as normal as possible. So, gotta say, it was a weird week. There was a bunch of injuries this week, some big-time sleepers, and slept-on top ballers. I predicted a Spamtown beatdown, but for the majority of the week, it looked like it was actually going to be a Mid-City murder. But when everything kind of settled into place, we arrived at 3-3 for each division, and crazy. We're all knotted up at 6-6 after 2 weeks, so hopefully I figure out how to edit all this stuff. But if I do, there's the music, and we dive right in with the game of the week, beginning with the Geese favored 190 over the football team. And I really, really thought that after getting embarrassed last week, Andrew would come back and be more focused this week. And I was wrong. Andrew covers, but this game was something he should have and could have won. Two biggest mistakes for the football team, forgetting to start D-Rose and Joker, and also starting Bryn Forbes over Lonzo Ball. Those two errors cost him 170 points. James beat him by 160 points. Andrew says he's not worried, but this is now the fourth week for the football team has finished as a bottom three manager. So uncoincidentally, he lost all three of his games that he lost came on one of those weeks. Something's got to change for him. Like, and if the playoffs started today, he would be playing the dreaded Alex Ciola in round one. So got to start some better habits, bro. I mean, like, each playoff matchup is 2 weeks long. Can't be slacking at any point in time during those 2 weeks. So Sabonis and Draymond led both teams in scoring. With the win, the Geese remain the 3 seed. Football team now teetering between the 6 and 7 seeds. I'm going to pay James his respect in the accolades, but for now, that's all I have to say about this game. I'm just temporarily forsaking my faith in my brother, I guess. I'm moving on. The Destroyers were favored by 135 over the Freak. It was the battle of the 4 and 2s, each team coming off a loss and trying to stay among the top four in the league. And it was the Freak and Friends drowning the Destroyers by nearly 200 points for that fourth spot. So while Lucas and Robert got their stars back, all of mine hit the IR. Both Cat and newly acquired Jimmy Butler were literally butthurt this entire week with bruised tailbones. I'd like to think that Lillard would think that's funny, but he can't laugh it off either because he's out with a abdominal tendinopathy. I hope that's not as scary as it sounds, but that's what he has. And Tobias Harris was sick as well. So add it all up and the Destroyers finished with less points this week than we did last week during Thanksgiving. So a rough week for the Destroyers. Vooch is back though, and he led my team in scoring with 194, and the Freak's Friends came to play, man. Embiid and Mobley led the team with 200-plus points each. Lucas and Robert are now 5-2 despite having the 7th highest most points scored in the league. I owe the Freak my respect for them beating me, but I still hold my ground on the fact that they are not going to be able to win without those big three. Giannis, Embiid, and Mobley have to be available. And let's not forget about Spider-Man either. Donovan Mitchell is definitely carrying his weight as well on this team, but he also finished in the top three for him for the Freak as well. So if the season ended today, the Freak and the Destroyers would face off in the first round as a 4-5 matchup. I still feel good about that matchup, but for this week, both James brothers take down the Schumachers. And I will stand with Andrew saying that we will get the best of them in March. No concerns there. The Muppets were favored by 420 over No Name. The Blaze Up Bull was a blowout. The Muppets beat the newly branded Ghost of Simmons by just less than 800 points, but that still wasn't even the biggest margin of victory this week. Stay tuned. There's a new head on the Muppet Monster, and his name is Darius Garland. Welcome to the party, to the prodigy, who scored 234 points and led all scorers in the matchup. The Muppets' streak of consecutive 200-plus days 200 point days came to an end on Tuesday this week. They ended the streak at 14 straight days, scoring 200 points or more. So kudos to Gavin on that. Hunter, big trade this week. Hunter ended up trading away his team's highest score in Jimmy Butler in return for a couple first-round picks and Kawhi Leonard from yours truly, the Destroyers. And so the tank is officially on for the winless Ghost of Simmons squad. And Hunter, he's shoring up that power forward spot, who is currently occupied by Blake Griffin, Brandon Clark, and Kevin Looney. So going forward, that's going to be a huge area that Hunter has now solidified in that power forward spot with acquiring Leonard. Louis, he's still steady chilling in Mexico right now anyway, so he's winning more than any of us at the moment. Gavin maintains control as the one seed in the league, and Hunter is the undisputed front runner for the 2023 first overall pick. Time to start scouting. Alex Ciola was favored 190 over the Heroes. The brother of the Boston Fat Old Men has rebranded once more, and please welcome the San Antonio Woman, abbreviation B. And you know they do things big in Texas. 800 points was the margin of victory for Al in this game. That was the largest of the league. Al had four players once again finish above the 200-point threshold. Jonas Valanciunas led all scorers for the Woman for the third time this season. Valanciunas had a 111-point game this week. That is a top five performance of the year. Crazy, crazy, crazy. And it was like watching disaster movie for Kevin this week. Okay. All right. So Kemba got benched indefinitely. Curry literally had the worst shooting performance of his career. And Bam Adebayo tore a muscle in his thumb and is going to miss at least a month of playing. But that's not even... None of those are the story that I want to talk about when it comes to Kevin, because I'm about to give my 60-second version of 60 Minutes. You've heard of Meta World Peace, but are you ready for Ennis Freedom? I've always preferred to call him Penis Cancer, but the Turkish-born baller changed his name to Freedom after officially becoming a United States citizen this last Monday. The Turkish government has issued like 10 arrest warrants for Mr. Freedom, Ennis, over his outspoken criticism of the political regime in Turkey. But now that he's an American, all he'll really need to worry about now is becoming an everyday role player again before he's kept to the curb, placed on food stamps, and smoking crack with the ghost of Lamar Odom. Because as you can see, he's averaging 19 points a game. So Godspeed, Mr. Freedom. We're all cheering for you, soldier. With the win, the San Antonio Women remain the 2 seed and now surpass the Geese in total points scored. After losing, the Heroes now fall out of the playoffs and are now a game and 300 points behind the 8 seed. There's some work to be done in Hermantown before Kevin can restore some dominance as he did last year. I think the Fat Old Men and the Heroes could help reach a trade that mutually benefits both of them. One of them's really guard heavy, and the other is really power forward heavy. There's got to be some sort of compliment there between the two teams. So go check on that. Go check on that, Kevin. Fat Old Men, speaking of them, they were favored by 240 over the Fighting Kwames. The prophecy reigns true. The Fat Old Men are now above 500 and firmly sitting at just 30 points back of my Destroyers for the 5th seed. But both teams came to play this week. Thank goodness. Dylan, he gets 303 points from Jared Allen. The Fro led the entire league in scoring this week, and he was complimented by another top baller performance by Trae Young. But it wasn't enough, because Tony and Jordan reached the podium again this week after getting 270 points from Brandon Ingram and 1,400 points from all of his friends. The story of this game, though, was Deshaun Tate of the Fighting Kwames, who went, this is the line, 11 for 15 from the field, 9 from 10 from the line, scoring 32 points with 10 boards, 7 assists, 2 steals, 5 blocks, and finishing with 107 fantasy points. And he did it all while sitting on Dylan's bench. So bittersweet for the Kwames. But they scored 365 points as a team on that day anyways, so they missed out on the chance to score 400 points in a day, but still wouldn't have been enough for them to actually win. Fat Old Men, they are currently the 6th seed, and the Kwames are literally 2, but reasonably 3 games back from any shot at the playoffs. And finally, the Fire Nation were favored 15 points over the Riots. This game lived up to the hype. There is a clear, an undeniable trend for the Fire Nation, unfortunately, this year, and is not good if you're Elliott. After getting his only win so far this season off of a comeback victory, a comeback Sunday performance over Kevin in Week 2, Elliott has now suffered three losses in which he has taken a commanding lead into Sunday and squandered it. The Riots looted all the points in the final hour and burned the Fire Nation's business to the ground by a 100-point margin. Didn't look good for Jack and Briar the entire week after they completely forgot to set their lineup on Tuesday and were down by nearly, they were down by more than 200 points entering Friday. And then they just outscored the Fire Nation by 100 and 150 on Saturday and Sunday to get the job done. It didn't end up changing the outcome of this game, but the Fire Nation's Kevin Porter Jr. got his first ever NBA triple-double on Monday, and then the league took it away. They just took it away. Those scoundrels. And it could have been, like, it's just, it's crazy how many different ways Elliott has gotten shafted in his young fantasy sports career, but we're finding new ways every day for Elliott. It's just sad. Jason Tatum and Avatar Luka, the two cornerstones of each team, they led the matchup in points. And I can't stress how big this game was for playoff implications for each team. If Elliott had won, he would have tied Jack and Briar at 2-4 and owned the tiebreaker in points scored. Instead, he's now a full two games back and slightly trailing Jack and Briar in points scored for that 8 seed. I've been wrong before, but only one of these two teams is going to make the playoffs, and it's looking more and more likely that it won't be the Fire Nation. We are dangerously close to playing the Mario Kart sad music for Elliott, but do not stick a fork in him yet. There's still half the season to be played, and we'd love to see it. That's it for your weekly recap. Now on to accolades. All right, so now for your top ballers. The streak continues for having a new top baller every week. Pretty cool. Jared Allen gets the job done. He gets top baller of the week this week. There's two fighting Kwames on this list, but they still lost. It just shows, man. Dylan, you got the star talent. It's there. It's just the 10 guys that come after him that's got to improve. After that happens, the fighting Kwames are looking good. But new names to this list, Darius Garland and Brandon Ingram, both make the list for the first time. Congrats, boys. And two football team players are in the shout-out column because one of them made the sleeper list and LaMelo just didn't play enough. But the sleepers this week, no surprise, Deshaun Tate gets the biggest sleeper. That's the biggest sleeper anyone's ever had. And not only because he had his 107-point game, but because Dylan also left him on the bench for a 53-point game as well later in the week. I would have thought that he would have started him after that 107 game, but, you know, that's a... It's tough to know how to manage your team when you're the Kwames. Joker is on this list for the second time this season. Shout out, Andrew. Funny little fact involving three of the Fire Nation players. So, Jeremiah Robinson Earl, you see him in that shout-out spot. That was the same spot that Jared Vanderbilt was in last week for Elliott. Robinson Earl earned that spot because he was on the bench in place of Jared Vanderbilt. And then Cameron Johnson is in the other shout-out spot because he was on the bench in place of Robinson Earl. So, gosh. I mean, long story short, it's just tough to manage fire, even if you're Fire Lord Newman. So that's your sleepers this week. Rookie of the year. Oh, shoot, I didn't write anything down for this. But, well, I'll tell you what. Evan Mobley, he won it for a fourth time this season, scoring 211 points. Scottie Barnes and Franz Wagner were right behind him, really, because they only played three games each. They could have easily gotten 200 points this week, too. All three of those guys had insane weeks. And then you say Alperen Sengunets and Cade Cunningham also on the list. And then a big drop-off between those two guys and then Quis Duarte for me. So your rookies are looking good. I'm not going to include any other like of the numbers and stuff like that for rookies. We're going to keep moving on because the managing this week was very interesting. So I added an extra column onto this chart this week because it's very important to note, I feel like, how many injuries we had this week. You see this extra injury column right here. There were 68 total players who ended the week as a day-to-day or out. That is 25% of all owned players. That is insane. Everyone was banged up this week. No one more than the ghost of Simmons, who had literally half his team on the IR. with 10 players. That's crazy. My Destroyers had 8. Lucas and Robert had 7, but it was just the different guys. I had all my stars out. They had their stars back. Same number of injuries, but just different guys. That got the job done for them. Also, the Fire Nation cursed with injuries, too. That was OG Ananobi, who didn't play for them, and a couple other guys. So just, again, the curse of the Fire Nation lives on. I'm not sure if you need to change your team to the Water Tribe or the Air Nomads to get the job done here, but I don't know, Elliot. It's some weird stuff. But a lot of injuries. And I totally owe Jaynes an apology because I was so certain that he won Manager of the Week. I haven't even mentioned Manager of the Week. Manager of the Week goes to Lucas and Robert again for having the best success rate ever for a manager with 98.4, even beating out Elliot in Week 2. But Jaynes did not have any points lost through the first four games or first 4 days of the week. So you see there, Geese 100% through Thursday, and they only made 2 mistakes. They just ended up costing them 7.5 points more than 6.5 points more than Lucas and Robert. So Jaynes definitely probably deserved the Manager of the Week, but you carded a dispute with the best success rate ever with Lucas and Robert. So Lucas and Robert now have won this award 3 times. That leads the league. I'm sure we'll probably see more of that going forward because their lineup fits together like a jigsaw puzzle. Like, they don't have a lot of guys to replace their guys with, but everyone falls into place. And so when they're healthy, it works. It really works for them. And then here you have the yearly totals for the managers. Geese move up in the standings. Heroes move up in the standings. Simmons moves down and Riots move down. Gavin's still only a half percentage point behind the Fire Nation for best manager success rate. Our top 20 performances, we had 2 of them. We had Jonas and then we had Deshaun Tate. The thing to note here is now everyone on this top 20 list is at 100 points or more. So you have to surpass 100 points now to make this list. Oklahoma City Thunder now have multiple games on this list. They're right there. Jokic and AD also still have 4 performances on this list, but Jokic is sitting right at that 20 spot. So as soon as someone gets something above him, he's kicked out. AD takes the lead. Now your podium for this week. At number 1, the San Antonio Women at 1,837. Mason City Muppets with 1,803. And the Boston Fat Old Men make the podium again this week with 1,703, exactly 100 points behind Gavin's Muppets. Gavin and Katie, by the way. Katie, shout out. I'm sorry. I've never acknowledged the fact that Gavin and Katie are co-managers. So, welcome, Mr. and Mrs. Muppet. And Med City beat out Spamtown this week by the slimmest of margins that we've had so far, by 53.5 points. And so Med City gets back on the horse and beats out Spamtown for totals. That is all we have for the accolades this week. Now we are on to previews. For your matchups this week, Destroyers -230 over the Fighting Kwames. Jimmy Butler will make his Destroyers debut for me, and it looks like Maxie's out for just a game or two with a non-COVID illness, but otherwise my guys should be relatively healthy again. Kwames are hot, they'll cover, but I'll win. Muppets -230 as well over the Football Team. It's a hell of a game for Andrew to have to play to and win to stay above 500. If he loses, he falls to 500. MPJ has officially been ruled out for the remainder of the season for the Football Team. He's getting his 3rd back surgery, but that's besides the point of this game. I think there is no doubt that Andrew covers this game, but I'm not betting on him to win until I see it happen. So give me the Muppets winning that game. Fat Old Men -100 over Fire Nation. God, this will be another great game to watch. Fat Old Men are on fire, and the Fire Nation are just trying to catch fire. Elliot still without Zion, OG, and Booker. Luka's even questionable for Tuesday, too. But, man, I really don't want to pick against Elliot, but I have no choice. Fat Old Men win and cover this game. The Freak, -15 over the Riots. This is another great game that will be watched. It gives me the same feelings. It's same kind of feel as what the Fat Old Men versus the Freak was. This time, the Freak's going to be at full strength, though. The Riots would have podiumed last week, actually, if they didn't forget to set their lineup on Tuesday. And they would they've been getting over 1,700 points for the last couple weeks now, and the Freak couldn't even get over 1,600 points with all of their guys back in the lineup last week. So I'm going to take the Riots winning this game. It should be as close as advertised, though, I have no doubt. Heroes, minus 125 over the Ghost of Simmons. Both of these teams are just in absolute turmoil right now. Hunter would have actually beaten the Heroes last week, even with this crippled roster and without Jimmy Butler. So that kind of shows you the dire straits that Kevin's team is in, too, right now. Bam is out for Kevin, but Curry will come back a lot stronger than he played last week for him. I'm going to take the Heroes winning and covering against the Ghost of Simmons as he vacations in Mexico. And then finally, the game of the week. Powerhouse matchup. This game has championship vibes written all over it. It's the San Antonio women favored 10 points over the Golden Geese. There's no way either of these teams meet again until maybe the semifinals or finals. They're not meeting the first round, that's for damn sure. Al has now finished with the highest weekly score for the past 2 weeks straight, and he particularly does well on even-numbered weeks for whatever reason. Normally, James is the only guy with stars that play on Tuesday and Sunday with his Westbrook-LeBron combo, but Al actually matches him in that department with his Harden and KD combo on those days. So I'm going to go stick with my instincts entirely with this game, and I'm going to take the San Antonio women in a thriller over the Geese. That means that I'm picking Spamtown to get the 4-2 advantage following this week. We will see. I had the Spamtown getting a 5-1 advantage last week, and that did not happen whatsoever. So we'll see if we can pull through. That's it for this week. That's it for week 7. Thank you all for watching, and we will see you next week. Peace.
Man down. Where you from, nigga? Fuck who you know. Where you from, nigga?